If COVID-19 has shown us anything, we've got to get better at understanding and trusting science. Scientists have been warning us for decades about the risks of a global pandemic. And until now, what did many countries do? Some had actually reduced spending or defunded projects and institutions that would have helped their citizens deal better with this COVID-19 pandemic. And for even longer, scientists have been warning us about climate change. It's also something we didn't really pay much attention to until now, when it's arguably already a bit too late. While the impact of COVID-19 was sharp and something we could react to somewhat quickly, climate change would likely be slower to hit us, but arguably much deadlier. The last few years have been the hottest on record for many places in the world, with extreme weather events that destroy lives and livelihoods becoming shockingly commonplace. When most people hear climate change or global warming, which are different things yet often used interchangeably, they imagine the majestic polar ice caps melting and flooding the planet, sinking Miami, Jakarta, Bangkok, Dhaka, and Venice. And while scientists agree that this is a real possibility, melting ice flooding everything isn't the main threat that should be keeping you up at night. We're joined by the professor and department head of emergency management at Jacksonville State University in the USA, Dr. Tanveer Islam. Just a small request, if you click on the subscribe button below and the bell icon, you'll get notifications every time we release a video. The world's getting hotter and 97 out of 100 currently publishing climate scientists blame human activity for the melting ice. Since the Earth climate is such a complex system, we're not 100% sure about exactly how a disaster may pan out, just like we couldn't quite predict the scale and scope of the COVID-19 pandemic. But one sure thing is that sea levels will rise. You see, in the 1990s, the Earth used to melt 760 billion tons of ice per year. Since the 2010s, this has increased to 1.2 trillion tons per year, a 60% increase within our lifetimes. Some of this ice is turning from ice to liquid underwater, which means sea levels aren't directly impacted. But much of the ice isn't underwater, and if this ice all melted, the sea level would rise 70 meters, about 230 feet. That's about enough water to cover London's Tower Bridge twice over or drown the entire Taj Mahal. Okay, that's a lot of water, but can't we just move away from the coasts? The issue is humanity loves water. We need it. We've built civilizations around water sources, and half the world's population lives in coastal regions. And we're not just talking about small fishing villages, we're talking about the biggest cities in the world. Tokyo, New York, Chittagong, Sao Paulo, Mumbai, and so many more. Even a tiny rise of a meter, just a meter, would cause catastrophic damage globally. A 10 meter rise, that's 33 feet, would displace 10% of all the human beings in the world, that's 630 million people. A 25 meter rise would displace 20%, and the full 70 meters would drown out all of Bangladesh, most of northern China, and create a brand new sea inside Australia. There would be no Miami, London, Venice, Netherlands. Africa would be mostly uninhabitable as a continent because of the extreme heat waves linked to changing weather patterns. Remember when we said sea levels rising aren't even the biggest problem? Well, the ice in the Antarctic and Arctic is all freshwater ice, like you find in rivers. The ocean, surprise surprise, is salty, which is over 97% of Earth's water. But why does this matter? Because of ocean currents. Ocean currents directly affect all our lives. They determine our weather, the climate, even how we get the oxygen we breathe. The ocean currents in wind systems move heat from the equator to the cold poles of the Earth, a bit like an engine. This great ocean conveyor is very important for our climate, a worldwide circulation system for our planet. It's also called the thermohaline circulation system. Thermo meaning temperature, and haline is the salt content. These two determine how dense the water is. Remember all that ice, that freshwater ice, melting into the salty oceans? That actually reduces the salinity or saltiness of the ocean via dilution, which reduces the density of the ocean, which impacts that thermohaline circulation. You see, thermohaline circulation relies on the cold, dense water sinking deep into the ocean. But as global warming makes the water at the surface less saline, it can prevent cold water from sinking, which stops the great ocean conveyor from working properly. All this mess will impact the Earth in different ways, and some of this is hard to predict. Europe is weirdly warm, considering, for example, that London is on the same latitude as Quebec, which is freezing cold, but much warmer on average because of the Gulf Stream, an important piece of the Great Ocean Conveyor, which moves warm water from the tropics to Europe. On the Indian subcontinent, the disruption in ocean currents due to the melting ice might mean a bigger temperature difference between the land and the sea in the tropical regions, affecting the yearly Indian monsoons and in turn creating devastating floods and droughts. The same exact melting ice caps and changes in thermohaline circulation could similarly disrupt the all-important African monsoons and bring more droughts throughout Africa. You'd expect dramatic weather events and changes to be happening more often due to the ocean current changes, for example, stronger hurricanes which cause more floods on top of the floods already being caused by melting ice. Some areas would have a lot more rain while other areas would dry out. This volatility is particularly dangerous for agriculture. You see, food instability leads to famines and increasing poverty. As a result, mass migration could collapse entire world governments and just make life really hard for us all. And we've had a small taste of that during this pandemic. On top of all of that, this ocean conveyor moves nutrients along with it. And as it just so happens, plants and plankton in the ocean are where we get more than 50% of our oxygen from. And it gets worse than that. All that melted ice would release CO2 into the atmosphere, because ice needs high CO2 to melt in the first place. So not only do we affect the amount of oxygen in the air by messing with water, by messing with ice, we'd also be messing with CO2. To wrap up, while scientists have different views on the impact climate change will have on the ocean conveyor system, but one thing is clear, we really don't want to mess with the thermohaline circulation system. Now you know exactly why melting ice is a threat to humanity. Please copy this video to your social media, your Instagram, your Facebook, even on WhatsApp, and help spread the word.